Hello friends, my name is Kalpesh and welcome back to my YouTube channel Automotive Cracks. I hope you guys are safe and healthy in this pandemic situation. So stay home and keep learning with me. If you haven't subscribed this channel, please click on the subscribe button and enjoy all the stuffs related to the automotive engineering at your fingertip. In this video, I'm going to discuss about the anti-squat and anti-pitch suspension geometry. Along with providing vertical compliance to absorb vehicle's vibration, suspension system helps to maintain the stability of vehicle and provides ride comfort to the occupants. So, let's understand the importance of the anti-squat and anti-pitch suspension geometry. In my previous videos of traction limited acceleration, you can observe this equation. This equation represents the rear axle load in the acceleration mode. This expression comprises two terms at the right hand side equation. The first term, it indicates the static load, and the second term it indicates the load transfer in the acceleration mode. So the second term, it indicates the weight transfer to the rear suspension due to the acceleration condition. Considering this weight transfer, you can observe that the rear suspension spring experiences the compressive force considering the rear drive vehicle. Thus, implied compression in terms of vehicle dynamics is known as a power squat. Due to this power squat in the rear drive vehicle, when rear suspension spring experiences the compressive forces, simultaneously the front suspension creates rebounds. This combination of rear jounce and front rebounds creates a pitching of the vehicles, and thus the suspension system must be designed to counteract the weight transfer effect, which is known as a pitch and squat. The geometry which produces the counteract forces, they are known as an anti-squat and anti-pitch suspension geometry. To understand the anti-squat suspension geometry, we have adapted the equivalent trailing arm analysis. Anti-squat forces can be generated on a rear drive axle by choice of the suspension geometry. The mechanics of this system can be understood most easily by recognizing that all suspension are functionally equivalent to a trailing arm with regard to the reaction of forces and moments onto the vehicle. So, to understand the whole phenomena, we have taken the small geometry of vehicle. In this this figure, you can observe that this geometry indicates the rear drive vehicle. This FX, it indicates the horizontal drive force. You can also call it the tractive force. This FZ, it indicates the vertical reaction against the axle load, or you can say it is the vertical reaction of the forces which are imposed due to the vertical loading component. This P1 and P2, they are trailing arm forces which are acting on the trailing arms, which are denoted here. In this phenomena, we had considered the assumption that static load is neglected in this analysis. Considering this geometry and considering the equilibrium condition and writing equation for the horizontal and the vertical forces and taking moment about point O, this is the point O. So, considering the equilibrium condition, we can write the equilibrium equations for the horizontal forces and the vertical forces. So, this indicates for the horizontal forces and this indicates for the vertical forces. And simultaneously, you can apply the moment equation in the equilibrium condition. So, the moment equation with moment, considering the moment about point O, this Fx into Z2, Fx into perpendicular distance from the point O, Z2, minus P1 cos theta 1 Z1, this P1 cos theta 1, it is the horizontal component of this trailing arm forces P1, horizontal component, and the perpendicular distance of this horizontal component from point O it is Z1. So it is, and the direction it is in the opposite direction, so considered negative. So P1 cos theta 1 into Z1 equals to 0. Now from this equation we can estimate P1 trailing arm forces P1, which must be equal to fx into z2 divided by z1 cos theta 1. Assuming angles are small and using values of P1 in the equation of horizontal forces. So this is the same equation that we have seen in the previous slide that we have considered for the horizontal forces. This fx, it indicates the drive force, tractive force, plus P1 cos theta 1, the horizontal component of the trailing arm force P1, and the horizontal component of trailing arm force P2. Here P2 force P2, it is in the opposite direction, so considered negative. And in the previous slide we have concluded with the values of P1. Now putting the value of P1 in the equation of horizontal forces, so finally we can estimate the values for the P2. So P2 it is equals to fx inside the bracket 1 plus z2 divided by z1 divided by cos theta 2. Now using the values of P1 and P2, we can resolve the fz from this equation. It is the equation that we have considered, that we get by considering the equilibrium condition for the vertical forces. So fc minus two vertical component of the trailing arm forces P1 and P2 respectively, considering the opposite direction, the negative sign considered here. So fz is equals to P1 sin theta 1 plus P2 sin theta 2. Putting the value of P1 and P2 in this equation, we are getting the value of fz in terms of fx, tractive force. This is the equation of vertical reaction force in terms of drive force. This is the same geometry that we have considered for the whole analysis. So from this geometry, if we are considering this triangle, then we can write the equation for the tan theta 1, which must be equal to the z2 plus z1 minus e, z1 plus z2 minus e. So we are getting this much distance divided by d whole span. And likewise we can consider this triangle, and we can write for the tan theta 2. So it is e minus z2 divided by d. It is very simple. We can simply write this equation with the help of, by simply applying the trigonometry on this geometry. Now with the help of this equation of tan theta 1 and tan theta 2, we are substituting the values in the previous equation of vertical reaction which we have derived in terms of drive force fx. So putting the values of tan theta 1 and tan theta 2 in this equation, just focus on this. So the values for tan theta 1 and tan theta 2 that we have derived in the previous slide from the geometry that we considered for the analysis, and putting the value of tan theta 1 and tan theta 2 in this equation, the fz divided by fx equals to z2 divided by z1 tan theta 1 plus 1 plus z2 divided by z1 outside the bracket tan theta 2. And now replacing this tan theta 1 and tan theta 2 by these values, by simple mathematical terms, we are getting z2 square plus z1 z into z2 minus ez2 plus ez1 minus z1 into z2 plus ez2 minus z2 square. Equalizing terms, so plus minus terms gets cancelled, this z2 square minus z2 square gets cancelled, z1 to z2 plus minus gets cancelled, e into z2 plus minus again gets cancelled, and finally we have e into z1 divided by d into z1 this Z1 gets cancelled, and finally we have a ratio of two forces in terms of E by D. So finally we have a ratio of the vertical reaction to the drive force, which must be equal to the E by D. This ratio, it depends on the two distances. E here, E, it indicates the distance of the intersection point of this trailing arm from the ground, and D, it indicates the distance of this intersection point from the axle. So this intersection point, it is known as a virtual reaction point, about which the whole geometry can swivel. So the torque reaction of the suspension control arms can be resolved into the equivalent longitudinal and vertical forces imposed on the vertical body. This virtual reaction point, it indicates that we can replace this trailing arms with the help of one single rigid trailing arm which has a length equal to the D and which is mounted above the ground level at a distance equals to the E. So higher the ratio of E by D, we are getting the higher percentage of the anti-squat mechanism. So if we are getting the E by D ratio, it is equals to 1, then we can say it is 100% anti-squat mechanism. But automotive manufacturers, they are not suggesting the 100% anti-squat geometry due to certain reasons. The effect of E by D that we are going to estimate in my next upcoming video. In the next videos, you will get the whole idea about the effect of this ratio E by D. As I said, the trailing arm can be replaced with the help of this E by D ratio, and we can change the geometry to achieve the anti-squat of the vehicle. So as the arm is rigidly fastened to the axle, it has the ability to transmit the vertical force to the sprung mass, which can be designated to the counteract squat. So thank you guys, thank you for watching my video with the attention. If you like this video, please do like and share with your friends, and don't forget to subscribe this channel.